Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to be with you on this, the 20th Sunday after Pentecost. In addition to this being the 20th Sunday after Pentecost, it is also our Harvest Home Sunday. The proceeds of our harvest giving this morning will go to the Lutheran pantry up at KU. And those who have items, if you have not already displayed them up front, you can bring them up during the singing of the first hymn as we sing, "Come, You Faithful People." Or thankful people, I think it is, right? Yep, come, you thankful people. I hope you're faithful as well, but get the words right, Ritter. Okay. There is a box on the table against the rear wall for any of your surveys that you may have brought with you this morning for the welcome statement. You may drop them in that box. If you did not, you have a chance next Sunday. That will be the conclusion of the opportunity to make your thoughts known regarding the welcome statement. And then they will be tabulated from that point on. Also this week, I think it was Monday, the weeks get so filled with many things, information was sent out so that people could do an online response. Again, we ask you to respond only one time, but you can respond that way if you wish, rather than bringing in a paper survey or filling a paper survey out in the back. Finally, we have up front and in the back copies of the 2021 updated time and talent sheet or form. We're urging you to get those in a timely fashion. If you have not already returned one, please take time to fill it out and return it at your convenience. All right, before I finish up with some other little tidbits for our worship this morning, is there anyone who has anything they would like to share at this time for the good of our community? Come on up, Steve.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name's Steve Fisher, for those of you who don't know me. Back there sits my wife, Charlene. She co-chairs with me. Through the think tank program here at Trinity, we got the idea of starting a worship service for the group of individuals who don't attend church for a variety of reasons. We researched what was currently available and found a nationally recognized program called Rejoicing Spirits. This program provides the opportunity for worship to individuals with intellectually and developmental disabilities. We are looking to initiate a Rejoicing Spirit worship site in our area here in our church. This means finding a handicapped accessible site, determining what materials are needed, and finding people to be available to help. This would include setting up, cleaning up, helping with wheelchairs, overseeing music needs, finding worship leaders, and that's just to name a few of them. There's tons of people that are needed. We have sent out information and a request to have interested people attend the meeting on October 21st. The purpose of this meeting is to find out if there's a community interest in having such a program. We send out letters to Kutztown, Fleetwood, and Topton churches. That's not just the Lutheran churches. That's all the churches in the area. We're asking to have them send people to that meeting to tell us if they're interested, if they can provide some help, or if we just should forget the whole thing. If you're interested in what I'm asking is, if you're interested, please let me know, let my wife know, let Pastor Ritter know. Seth would also be another one you could talk to and let him know. Thank you.
And you'll hear more and see more in the bulletin about that 21st meeting. All right. Are there any other items for the good of our community this morning? Now I want to take this opportunity again to thank Bruce and our choir for their worship leadership today. Kellen, thank you for taking care of the tech, and I believe Alicia's back behind one of the other screens there, Alicia Wood, for taking care of the technology and making that work. Dr. Piscitelli, Joe, thank you for being our lector, and Nargiza for your work as our assisting minister, and of course, Florida for the closed captioning that you provide. In addition, we started last Sunday, and it's something we'll continue doing, during the time of the passing of the peace, and this is to all of you out in Zoom land, as well as you here in worship, we're going to take opportunity to have some interaction between us. If you want to see the folks, you look on the monitors. If you want to wave to them, you have to turn around and face the camera back there on the wall, or you're going to have this one going today to do it? All right. Last week we had a face back there because they weren't getting this camera going. So you can do it up here, just wave, and you'll see folks on the monitor, and we can bring each other somewhat together. Although we can't rub elbows, we can wave at each other and wish each other the peace of God through Jesus Christ. All right, that's it for me. Let us continue our worship with our opening hymn. Oh, we have a confession and forgiveness. I need a look at my bulletin. Thank you, dear wife. All right. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose teaching is life, whose presence is sure, and whose love is endless. Let us confess our sins to the one who welcomes us with an open heart. God, our Comforter, like lost sheep, we have gone astray. We gaze upon abundance and see scarcity. We turn our faces away from injustice and oppression. We exploit the earth with our apathy and greed. Free us from our sin, gracious God. Listen when we call out to you for help. Lead us by your love to love our neighbors as ourselves. Amen. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. By the gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes you righteous. Receive with glad hearts the forgiveness of all your sins. And again, during the singing of the hymn, please bring your Harvest Home contributions. If you have them in a bag, take them out so that they're all can be visually on display here.
the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O Lord, maker of all things, you open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living creature. We praise you for crowning the fields with your blessings and enabling us once more to gather in the fruits of the earth. Teach us to use your gifts carefully, that our land may continue to yield in its increase through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
A reading from Deuteronomy chapter 26. When you have come into the land that the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance to possess, and you possess it and settle in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground, which you harvest from the land that the Lord your God is giving you, and you shall put it in a basket and go to the place that the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling for his name. You shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, "Today I declare to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our ancestors to give us." When the priest takes the basket from your hand and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, you shall make this response before the Lord your God: "A wandering Armenian was by my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in number, and there he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us by imposing hard labor on us, we cried to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. The Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with a terrifying display of power, and with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me. You shall set it down before the Lord your God and bow down before the Lord your God. Then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 9. The point is this: the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every work. As it is written, "He scatters abroad, he gives to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for your great generosity, which will produce thanksgiving to God through us. For the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. Through the testing of this ministry, you glorify God by your obedience to the confession of the gospel of Christ, and by generosity of your sharing with them and with all others, while they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God that he has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Word of God, word of truth.
Holy Gospel comes into our midst this day in the 13th chapter of Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus put before them another parable. Kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field, but while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat, and then went away. But when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from? He answered, An enemy has done this. The slaves said to him, Then do you want us to go and gather them? But he replied, No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest, and at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, collect the weeds first, and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn. Then Jesus left the crowds and went into the house, and his disciples approached him, saying, Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field. He answered, This one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one. And the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers. They will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So today, for our sermon for all ages, I thought I'd talk a little quickly about our harvest home here. So today is a very special Sunday. We sometimes call it Harvest Home Sunday. And I wanted to share, so all of this food that many people have brought over a couple weeks and different things, all of this food is going to what we call the student food pantry. And I wanted to just talk about that really briefly for those of you maybe who don't know much about the student food pantry or maybe haven't even heard of it until today. So the student food pantry is held up at our Lutheran house up on campus, and it's easy to remember because it's called the Lutheran Center. And so we host the food pantry on our first floor. And let me tell you something, when we first found out why we wanted to do a food pantry at the campus was we went to this seminar where they talked about food issues on campus. And I don't know about you guys, but I never really thought about that. Because in my head, I was like, oh, a lot of them, you know, maybe the parents can help buy the food and those kind of things. But there's a lot of kids whose parents maybe can't afford it or who maybe don't have contact with their parents. And we found out that roughly 1 in 10 college students have at one point said they had to go hungry through their school year. 1 in 10, that's a lot of kids. And so we started a food pantry, and the first time we ever did it, we had one kid show up. And then the next week we had 2 kids show up, and then the next week we had 4, so we were like doubling our numbers every week. And by the end of our first year, we were getting about 20, 30 kids. And then the next year after that, we got someone, his name is Ryan Turk. A lot of you know Chris Turk, his mother, and their members here. He started working at our food pantry and took over, and we said, oh, get ready for about 30 kids. And we had 90 kids the first week of the second year. And so that was all before COVID. We were getting about a little over 100 kids every week. And then COVID hit, and obviously numbers shrank at KU. And now that we're back to this year, we're now getting again, we get about probably close to 70 kids every week. And all of those kids come from a lot of different backgrounds. They all, you know, are in different majors in college. They all look different. They all act different. But they're all always usually really grateful for all the food that's there. And here's a thing. I know this number is hard to think about, but we order close to two tons of food. Tons is sometimes just used when you're talking something big, but that we actually order 2 tons of food usually in a week. And so I just wanted to share that with you guys because it's so helpful to know where our food is going to help people. And I will also say, if any of you would like, I am there every Wednesday and helping there. So if any of you would ever just like to look at what our food pantry is doing, or any families, we would love to have you to show you around. We're really proud of it. But that's what our food is going towards. And that's when we pray and when we celebrate today, we're praying, you know, that God helps give us a spirit of gratitude, that sometimes when we have a lot, that maybe we can share that with people who don't. And so that's a lot of why we're doing this Harvest Home. It's to remind us of all the things we have and the things that maybe of our all that we have that we can share. So let me say a prayer for us. Dear God, we give you thanks. Thank you for this Harvest Home. Thank you for people who are generous with the things we have. And Lord, we pray for those who maybe don't have food today, who are hungry, and may this food reach them. In your name, amen. Thank you, everybody.
I ought to take a moment here. Debbie, who was here yesterday to help you? Marcia?
Marcia
Hoyer and Debbie Ziegler got all of this arranged for us and managed and arranged to get the corn shock stalks there so that we can have a Harvest Home this week. I don't know if that was real clear, but if you didn't bring something today, you can bring something anytime and we'll get it up to the Lutheran Center for you. All you do is put it out. Generally, we have a basket or over by the one pillar, you'll often see some bags. Just put them out here in the entry area of our church when you bring items, and we will get them up there. All non-perishables, if you have any leftover things from the garden, just let us know that you're bringing them, and we'll get them up there more quickly and get them refrigerated or whatever we need to do so that they can be held till the students come in for pantry. I don't know about you, how you got here this morning. Some of you I know live in town. I live out in Lyons, and every day that I come in to work, I drive past copious fields of corn that are now being harvested. Hundreds of acres on either side of me being harvested and provided for a whole variety of needs. Earlier this year, we saw the grain fields producing their bounty. And we are reminded of the bounty of this community. We drive around, we've got farm stands all over the place with loads and loads of fresh produce. Two congregations that I served as transitional pastor both began community gardens to provide fresh produce for the food pantry at Friend Incorporated and other food pantries in their community. And that's the sad part, isn't it? That amidst all of this bounty, we have people who struggle with food insecurity day in and day out. something needs to change. And I don't know that I have the answers. I just know that that's not what God intends for us or for anyone, especially young children. And I volunteer up at Friend Incorporated on pantry days, and you realize most of the individuals going to pantry are seniors in our area, in our community. And then the other alternative is families with young children. Those are the two main groups that attend the pantry here at Friend Incorporated. And this week, we celebrate the bounty of the harvest. And I think it ought to remind us that God calls us not only to be generous in our living, but to be patient. Sometimes we want things to change very quickly, but often it takes patience. When I was a young boy, and I make apologies to those who attended Bible study this week, you've heard this story before. When I was a young boy, living on my out at the edge of my grandfather's farm, around mid-June, my grandfather would gather up my cousins and myself who lived on the farm, along with him, my uncle and my father, we would stand at the end of our grain fields, and we would stick out our arms so that our fingertips would touch each other, and we would proceed to walk the length of the fields through the rows, just as the grain was beginning to turn yellow, but not quite that light green, just getting ready to be yellow, because the thing that would cause them, what would stand out, would be the very dark green thistle plants that also got into the field. Now, I don't know about an enemy in this case. It was probably the wind that blew the seed there from the year before. But what we would do is we would walk through the fields and we'd get to a thistle and we'd take the top of the thistle and break it off and throw it on the ground. See, my grandfather grew barley, wheat, and oats with the purpose of providing them as seed for the coming year, so that the grain my grandfather grew, he sold to someone, a middleman, who would take care of getting it ready for planting the next year. And the money my grandfather would get per bushel depended upon the amount of weed seed that was in that bushel that was tested. And so we tried to make sure that there was very little weed seed in that. But we understood what Jesus talked about today. You couldn't pull the thistle plant out. You just had to make it unable to produce more thistles. So we threw them on the ground so they wouldn't end up in the harvest. Different farming methods today cause us to do things differently from what the scriptures tell us Jesus suggested, or that master suggested to his servants. Years ago, when you would gather up the grain and you thresh it on a threshing floor, you could separate the weeds at the end. But my grandfather understood you had to do it before, or it wouldn't make any difference. But you can't still pull the plant out because you destroy a lot of wheat around that thistle plant as well. And so came up with this unique idea. I don't know if he read it in a Pennsylvania Farmer's Journal or some such magazine, or he understood what he needed to do to prevent his grain from being less valuable and maybe even rejected as seed grain. But I think that story reminds us that even in real life, we need to be a bit more patient, perhaps, than we are in this give it to me now generation in this world. That wants instant gratification, instant everything. We often are short on patience. Patience and understanding and empathy to deal with those who are different from us or who seem to be a problem in the world and in society. In 2011, James Hodgkinson was a 28-year-old young man studying to be a paramedic within training. And he had decided to go out for a night on the town with some friends. And something evolved during that night, and an altercation developed, and someone on the other side took their fist and punched James on the jaw, hard enough to knock him out. And he hit the ground. By the time they got him to the hospital, they realized it was more than a hard punch. He was bleeding into his brain. And he died within a couple of days after having been put on life support. Jacob Dunn was the young man who threw the punch. After he punched James, he took off. He didn't want to get into any trouble. And it was almost a month before he realized that the punch he threw was a fatal punch. Jacob had led a rather troubled teenage life, always a problem child, they said, always a troublemaker. Problems in school, didn't do well in school, dropped out early, didn't finish. And now the police came and he was arrested. He ended up serving what was considered a very light sentence, only 13 months. Many in the justice system could not understand how he got that light a sentence. But 13 months was enough to increase his anger and his alienation from society. And when he was let go, he had no place to stay. His friends, he had written them off because they had turned him in. How could they do that to him? They were his friends, right? So he sank lower and lower. The parents, Joan and David, of the young man who was killed, had been in counseling to try to deal with their anger and their pain, their sorrow, their sadness, the loss of their only son. And in the process, one of the therapists happened to mention to them about an organization that was available to them to do remedial justice. And they got in touch with the organization, and one of its members came out and talked to them and said, begin to write some letters back and forth with Jacob. Let him know what's wrong, what's going on for you. Share with him your question. And we'll talk with him if he's available and willing to do that. And he was. And so they began a 2-year period of exchanging letters back and forth, sharing who they were and what was going on in their lives. During that 2-year period, Jacob began to change his life. He went back and took his GED equivalency, and began to think about going to college, to a university. At the end of 2 years, after several letters exchanged between them, they agreed to meet each other. And as Joan, the mother, writes, a lot of tears were shed that day by all who were in that room. Many would have thrown Jacob's life away. He was considered to be unredeemable by many. Jacob writes this, if they had never challenged me with those difficult questions, I would most likely still be in prison today. It's extraordinary to think that the people I harmed the most were the people to judge me the least. Many would have rooted Jacob out of society, thrown him away, locked the door, and thrown the key away. But Joan and David, the parents of the slain man, realized there was value in this human life. Where do you need to practice patience? I think it's one of the hardest things farmers have to do, is to practice patience. I saw it on my grandfather's face and my dad's face often, looking out to the northwest where the rains often come from, worried that crops were drying in the fields some years, that the harvest was going to be poor. But there was nothing they could do, just like there was nothing they could do about those thistles coming into the field. The wind blows where it will. Thistles travel where they will. It isn't easy to be patient. It isn't easy to be generous. That second passage of scripture we had today that Paul wrote to the church in Corinth. Even though the sower is bountiful, even though the one who provides the seed is bountiful, even though God is bountiful, it isn't easy to be generous. And it isn't easy sometimes for us to be thankful. There are many who, there is nothing such as enough in their lives. So today, on this Harvest Home Sunday, lessons remind us, be patient, to trust God's bounty and to be generous. Above all, to be thankful for the gift of the harvest and the bounty around us. Thankful enough that we might share the blessings of this world and of our faith with those who are in need. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, everlasting. Amen.
Made children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need.
Uniting God, you call forth different gifts of those who follow you. Encourage us to welcome the diverse benefits and blessings of the whole church in teaching, preaching, prophecy, healing, and more. Bless bishops Eaton and DeForest as they seek to lead the national and synodical expressions of our church. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Nurturing God, you bring forth crops from the soil and bounty from the trees. Increase the produce of land and bless all who toil in fields and orchards. Provide for good working conditions and keep them safe. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Empowering God, you offer compassion for those who are overlooked or forgotten. Open the hearts of local, national, and world leaders to show such compassion and love for their neighbors. Watch over the millions of refugees in these days who have been forced to flee their homeland because of violence or natural disasters. Grant that they might find safe havens, rest, and food. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Sheltering God, in Jesus you traveled among us without a place to lay your head. Provide safe places to sleep and rest for those whose home are the streets or woodlands of our nation. Sustain ministries that offer food, clothing, and peace of mind, such as Friend Inc., Safe Harbor, and Hope Rescue Mission. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comforting God, be with those who serve in healthcare. They have struggled mightily to bring us through this pandemic and often at great cost to themselves and their families. Grant that they may find time for renewal and rest. Be with all who struggle with injury or illness of any kind, especially
Kathy, Sherwood and Jean, Ray, Gail, Russell, Keith, Leroy, Phyllis, Elizabeth, Annabelle, Judy, Barbara, Kenneth, Joyce, Rita, Judy, Sharon, Deb, Beau, Joe, Lillian, Gary, Madison, Betty, Joan, Missy, and Kendall.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Renewing God, you bring life out of death. Help us part with those things that are no longer beneficial to us and open our hearts to see where new life is budding in this congregation. Give to us the gift of discernment that we may discover your will for us in this time of transition and beyond. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For those who have reasons to celebrate these days, especially Victoria Kunkel, Bennett Fink, Matthew Ziegler, Denise Yerger, Sarah Kyle, Gabriella Parker, Angie Fegley, and Parker Keglevitz on the occasions of their birthdays. Lord, in your mercy,
Hear our prayer.
Eternal God, we thank you for the lives of those who have died, especially Darlene Riffle, and those we have remembered before you now. Make us confident in your promise of salvation and support us in our own journey of faith. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Peace of Christ be with you always. Let us share that peace now with each other. Peace be with you.
Pastor?
Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
I'll give you your message.
Okay. Okay. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Nancy.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you, everyone. You can turn your cameras on out there in Zoom land. That we can see you. Peace be with all of you. Peace, Paul. I guess they want to see us and we don't want us to see them. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you, everyone.
Good choice of song, Bruce. This is a good song. Matt Redman, yeah. Yeah. That's an oldie. I know, and those are the ones that are really great.
If you did not get a communion cup, there's some up front and in the back so that you're ready to receive the sacrament when we are at that point of the service in a few minutes.
Everything that must breath, praise the Lord.
Let us pray. God of abundance, you cause streams to break forth in the desert and manna to rain from the heavens. Accept the gifts you have first given us. Unite them with the offering of our lives to nourish the world you love so dearly. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. You remove your mask and prepare to commune. Receive the sacrament. You have opened and pulled out your wafer. The body of Christ given for you. And in like manner, we now receive the body, the blood of Jesus, the blood of Christ shed for you. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace now and forever. Amen. Let us pray. Lord of life, in the gift of your body and blood, you turn the crumbs of our faith into a feast of salvation. Send us forth into the world with shouts of joy, bearing witness to the abundance of your love in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Now, people of God, you are Christ's body, bringing new life to a suffering world. The Holy Trinity, one God, bless you now and forever. Amen. Alleluia.
Peace, the living word dwells in you.